Hello, children. I hope you're ready to sit down and talk about some spooks and scary stuff. Things that go bump in the night. Yeah, I know I've done the candle bit before. Whatever, sue me. It's a good bit. Fear is an interesting concept to me, both the psychological concept as well as the video game. Fear as a psychological concept wasn't ever really something that I super was into as a young strapping lad, mostly because of, you know, being a little baby. And also just because my family was also a whole bunch of babies. So I never really got to experience a whole lot of spooky stuff as a kid. Never saw The Ring, never saw Alien, etc. The scariest movie that I saw was Predator, which... it's one of my favorite movies of all time, but that's because, you know, it's a reverse horror movie. Well, it's a reverse action movie, I guess, where it starts off as an action movie and then becomes a horror movie. But I digress. That is neither here nor there, at least for today. What I really wanted to talk about was fear. And this time, I actually mean fear. See, the Fear video game was actually something that I didn't experience when it first came out, mostly due to it coming out in 2005, and, you know, I was still a relatively small child at the time, so I wasn't really allowed to just go out and buy whatever video games I wanted to, and as aforementioned, family was also not into scary things. I didn't really know about it until I started babysitting my neighbor's kids for a little bit there in high school. I don't know, they were like 4 and 6, or 3 and 6, or something like that. And, you know, he had an Xbox, so I'd go over, we'd play Xbox, we'd watch movies, whatever. And perusing through the collection, I eventually discovered the game Fear, First Encounter Assault Recon. And, of course, looking at the box, that's one of those games that's like, holy shit, this looks amazing. The game is so spooky, they called the game Fear. It's gotta be good, right? Of course, also, I was looking at it, and I was like, oh, this is gonna be more like a, this is gonna be more like a Doom 3 than anything else. It's gonna be more... like action and shooty, and like it also kind of looked like Doom 3 in the screenshot, so I was like, whatever, it'll be fine. I about goddamn near pissed myself that night, and that was a foundational moment of my childhood, and I cherish every moment that I had with that game, and it was wonderful, and I hated every second of it, and that made it even more wonderful. In fact, it was so influential to me that I don't remember if it was actually around this time of year or not. It might have been, now that I think about it, but I actually had one of my friends in high school come spend the night, and we were hanging out all night and playing video games, and I was like, hey, I found this new game that I really want you to play. So at this point, I had already played it quite a bit, and got to the point where Alma kind of sneaks around the corner and spooks you, like the first time you see a glimpse of her, and that moment terrified me, and I turned off the game right there and then, so I was like, haha, I know what I'm gonna do, and invited my friend over, and I was like, hey, let's play this cool game. Heard a lot about it. Let him play. I was a bit of a dickhead. We got to that scene, and of course, he just noped the fuck out, so... sorry, Keith. Yeah, it's kind of amazing how much just the concept of fear was never something that I really dove into until this game actually made me come to terms with what it is that fear actually is. And fear is one of those things that you can experience that is a physical reaction, but it's also one of those things that can be psychological, and it can be mental. And this game... is really good in that regard. So, yeah, without any further ado, I think it's time that we spend a little bit of time, enjoy the reason for the season. That smoke is in my face now. I didn't think that plan through. And we're just gonna play some video games. And hope that I don't set my couch on fire. I need a new bit for next year. Monolith Productions, the company behind the likes of Blood, The Matrix Online, and Middle-earth Shadow of War, are the team behind this game, and it really does show with their focus on taking the standard first-person shooter formula and adding their spin and flavor on the concept, and introducing some light simulation elements and, of course, baking horror elements into the game's tech at a very core level with how its lighting engine was built and even how levels were designed.
it's a game that I would love to completely forget and experience again, as it still scratches that mid-90s to mid-2000s shooter itch that you can't really get scratched these days in the same way. And on top of that, it's a compelling horror experience that genuinely made me uncomfortable in spots. All right, let's go ahead and get me talking about the game mechanics and all that out of the way so we can focus on the story and some of the technical aspects of the game that make this game such a cult classic. The gameplay is almost like a survival horror experience in spots, which is an amazing concept and kinds of hits those same vibes that Doom 3 hit for me back in the day, but somehow didn't go quite as arcadey and went even more horror, which is impressive considering how arcadey is a word that nobody in the universe has ever used in the history of the internet to describe Doom 3 before. The game takes full advantage of systems that, on paper, are annoying in your average FPS and turns them into genuine hostile combatants that you have to deal with, just as much as you would deal with the AI. There's a 3-weapon limit, and while you can swap weapons with newer ones you find as you go, ammo is pretty limited in general, but especially applies for weapons that are not found in the current level you are in. You might have to make some difficult decisions between keeping the pistol around that has less rapid-fire potential, but great headshot potential and a ton of spare ammo, and a rocket launcher that could be super helpful for an upcoming boss fight, but then you'll be down a third gun until you use it on said boss, which is a game design trope that I really actually enjoyed experiencing in titles like Resident Evil 1 Remake, but they don't typically work very well in first-person shooters. Somehow Monolith pulled it off amazingly. There's a tiny bit of imbalance with the weapons once the shotgun gets introduced, as it has a very high damage output on top of being very slow to actually expend said ammo. Unlike other guns like the SMG, where you can dump 50 bullets in about 2 seconds if you aren't paying attention. This makes it very difficult for me to run out of ammo in some levels, but those levels were usually early on, and in the late game when ammo is more rare, you get more power weapons to choose from, so the choice is much more difficult to make, and more fun in my opinion at least. Do you choose to swap out your shotgun for the assault rifle that the enemies are carrying this level, just so you can make sure that you have ammo coming in, meaning that you can still carry your nail gun and the sniper rifle for an emergency boss fight that might pop up, or do you drop the sniper rifle and carry the AR and the shotgun so that you just don't have to think about it? The game is satisfyingly stressing on the player, while not exactly difficult, at least not for 2023, James. The AI is extremely intelligent and will actively try to flank you and outmaneuver you in ways that AI in modern games still don't really match. The only real example of another game with similar quality AI I can think of is Halo, but I would honestly give more praise to F.E.A.R. in this regard. The AI is that damn good. Your health is a weird system in this game. Armor exists, but it doesn't really help that much. It's fairly rare and it disappears pretty quick. But it does function as a separate health pool so it can save your ass if you get a surprise grenade thrown around you when you're stuck in a corner. Healing comes in the form of health packs. You can carry as many as 10 at a time, and they are instant use via a hotkey. They heal 50 health with each press. There are some health increases you can find in hidden spots that increase your health by 5 units at a time up to a maximum of 199, and they also fully heal you when you pick one up. I, unfortunately, played the game on medium difficulty for reasons we'll talk about in just a moment, but it led to many situations where I was fully stacked up on health packs and health and ammo really just weren't too much of a concern for 90% of the game because of that. This is also exacerbated by one of the selling points of the combat in this game, bullet time. Bullet time makes the combat piss easy to kill people and avoid taking damage. It's honestly incredibly overpowered, and I would recommend to most people who find the game too easy to just unbind the button for a much different experience. I never actually finished F.E.A.R. my first playthrough. I actually encountered a really game-breaking bug, or at least I'm assuming it's a game-breaking bug. I can't really find out any information on if this mechanic was a thing or not, and quite frankly, I don't really want to start another playthrough to figure it out myself. But I started off I believe it's Interlude 4, where you start off the rooftop scene where you're flown in via helicopter to land on the rooftop of HQ, because that's where the troops are invading. And in this playthrough, my character is properly healed. In my first playthrough, I had no healing whatsoever. I had like 10 HP, no armor, barely any ammo, and of course, as soon as you get off the chopper, everybody lights you up. So, yeah, not a great first impression to this game, and it was actually one of the reasons why I put off playing F.E.A.R. for as long as I did. It's one of those things that when you're playing it, and again, to be quite honest, this could entirely be my fault because it could be a difficulty thing,
But it's one of those things where when you're playing it and you come across it and there's literally no way to win the situation, well, the only winning move is to just not play at all, right? So unfortunately, game got shelved. I'm not sure if it's just because of the fact that I was like 14 and thought I had a ginormous cock and played it on the hardest difficulty possible, or if it was an actual game bug exclusive to the 360 version. I don't know. Like I said, I spent like a grand total of like 90 seconds Googling this and couldn't find any information about difficulty specific health, and then went, it's probably fine, and then just moved on with writing the script. So yeah. Kind of a shame, though, because the game is actually fantastic.
Creepy atmosphere is a dime a dozen these days. I mean, look at all the Five Nights at Freddy's fan games or the PS1/VCR-style horror experiences that are in vogue right now with the indie crowd. It takes a special mix of different elements to really pull it off without coming off as comical or accidentally releasing tension or making the experience a joke. And that wasn't really found in gaming, in large scales at least, until fairly recently. Ironically enough, with the rise of the Five Nights at Freddy's franchise. That's why F.E.A.R. is such an interesting experience to me. It's genuinely creepy, even without the story elements. The ambient noise you hear while wandering around, environmental lighting, and storytelling with how certain areas are blocked off or boarded up. Hell, even the way the levels themselves are designed. This all attributes to this feeling of uncertainty and apprehension because you just never know what you're going to experience around the next corner. The story ties into the experience in so many fascinating ways, as you just witnessed. That hallucination is courtesy of Paxton Fettel, the individual who sets off the course of the entire game in some ways, and is the primary antagonist for the first, I'll say, two-thirds of the game? Fettel is the result of genetic experiments, one of two prototypes for psychic warriors. He controls an entire battalion of soldiers that are psychically linked to him, and at the start of the game starts an uprising with their help. You spend a lot of time trailing him, trying to stop him, as if he dies, it will deactivate all of the other soldiers. And this entire time he's messing with you with hallucinations, some as minor as sounds or whispers in a hallway. Sometimes it can be flashbacks to memories that definitely don't belong to you, or him for that matter, such as a woman having her baby taken away immediately after birth. And sometimes it can become full-on David Lynchian nightmare rooms where you are teleported to another dimension and explore more and more detailed hospital environments. Or you just fight demons in hell.
You still don't know, do you? What you are. Why you're here. What's the first thing you remember? What's your given name? Where were you born?
The base game is creepy, sure. But add the story elements on top of it, and it elevates the entire experience to a new level, and one that really just wasn't done much of at the time. I alluded to Doom 3 earlier, and that applies to this game in more ways than you would really expect. Both games feature a singular bad guy introduced early on that you really just don't like because he's essentially immediately evil. And shortly after that introduction, paranormal events begin to happen, and you spend the majority of the game chasing this individual in an attempt to kill them so that you... they can stop making everything suck so bad. You eventually realize the guy you thought was the big bad wasn't actually the big bad. You make moves to stop the plans of the real big bad, you succeed, and then the game ends with a cliffhanger that implies things are mostly good, but then there's a whole lot of implications that you didn't actually fix the problem and it's just delayed the bad stuff from happening. It's really funny how much this game wears its horror influences on its sleeve. Yeah, you just sat through a Doom 3 montage, I know, but there's a ton of references to Aliens as well, the James Cameron sequel to one of my favorite movies of all time. For example, the music has twinges in it that make me think of Aliens here and there, and the SMG's firing noise and rate of fire are very reminiscent of the Colonial Marines pulse rifle. It's the things like this that really make me nostalgic and go, haha, I know what you're doing, but there's a ton of smaller nods here and there and that really show how much the team loved this movie. Like one of the smaller characters being named Bishop.
Just sit tight, Mr.
Bishop. Aldous Bishop.
There's even a very on-the-nose reference to Jurassic Park with one of the characters being a large man who's good with computers. See, his belt says, read the fucking manual, get it.
It also pays a lot of homage to Japanese horror movies with the fairly obvious references to The Ring, you know, the whole small girl thing. But I also got introduced to some amazing movies thanks to some research on the game, like The Eye, which is a downright horrific psychological terror experience, where this lady who is blind gets transplanted eyes, and then after that she starts to see terrifying shadows and, like dead people who are, like, following her around, and, like... Huh. Wholly recommend, but it's a subs not dubs affair. I highly recommend at least watching the famous elevator scene on YouTube, and you'll immediately see the influence this movie had on the game. The personality this game oozes is just fantastic, and it makes me sad that we probably won't experience anything like it in the modern era. Monolith is still around, obviously, but they make games like Middle Earth: Shadow of War these days, and with a TBA Wonder Woman title in production by the studio, I think it's safe to say that their horror days are behind them, well, at least for now. Their engine, Lithtech, I'm not sure how to pronounce that, it's still around to this day, though now it's referred to as Firebird in Shadow of War, which is a good thing in my opinion, because some of the features of this engine are absolutely mind-blowing, and some modern games still can't touch some of these features, and this is game 2005. It's designed to be played on 640 by 480. Like, what the hell? One of my favorite technical features of this game is the bullet hole system. It uses parallax visual effects to make it look like geometry is being deformed. But in all actuality, there's flat textures. Parallax bullet holes is one of the coolest pieces of tech I've ever seen. For the longest time, I thought F.E.A.R. was the first game to feature the technology, but the internet is now telling me that Splinter Cell Chaos Theory was actually first to market with this. But to be fair, that game only came out like 6 months before F.E.A.R., meaning they both had to be like working on the tech around the same idea, and both games would have entered production roughly around the same time, so clearly the idea was out there, and it had to come from somewhere. I just love that I can't seem to get away from Splinter Cell now on this show, so that's a problem. The game also features my favorite thing ever, actually black, like inky black shadows. This game uses shadow volumes, another tie to Doom 3, which is what allows the shadows to be pixel-perfect whatever is causing them. It looks downright stunning at times, especially when combined with their particle systems and other technologies like their per-pixel lighting system that this game uses. It's so good-looking. Hell, the engine is weirdly complicated in even weirder ways. This game has super sampling. In 2005! The term super sampling didn't even exist yet. That came years later, like what, the early to mid 2010s? Unfortunately, the game itself has some crippling tech debt that I don't really blame them for having. For example, the fonts, the HUD, etc. are hard-coded to display at 640 by 480. I actually had to get a mod to play the game at 4K properly. But when I did that, for some reason, the first like session that I played also increased the size of the green info text blurbs whenever I quicksave. For example, which was funny, but then I quit and I came back to it, and then like a few days later when I came back, it just stopped happening. So you know, that's cool. There's also like a really weird low-level engine bug where if you use modern Logitech devices, it makes the game run at like 7 frames a second. I have no idea what could possibly be causing this and why only on Logitech devices that are like relatively modern. But like there's a mod to fix it, so like it's not a big deal, but it was just super weird and like very noteworthy. Speaking of weird low-level engine bugs, I think I encountered one several times with the underlying network engine. It may even be lower level than that with some of the math libraries, I don't really know. Every so often it felt like the game's movement prediction would mess up and not realize that I was stopping, and it would kind of move me further, like it would rubber band me like into walls and stuff, but then it would immediately correct that, and then I wouldn't be able to like back up and do it again. So the reason why I said that like I think this is the netcode is that it's like it almost feels like the game's local server that it runs, which is very common practice for engines, especially shooter games back then. Source and id Tech do this, for example. You just run a local server and all the code executes that. Doesn't matter. It makes me feel like the local engine isn't running at a high enough tick rate to keep up with my movements, and especially with how my modern computer can run the game. And like the movement prediction code is like messing up and it's like interpolating further than it should. Like I said earlier too, it's also possible that it could be something way more basic. Like I'm just encountering rounding precision errors when I move fast for a while and stop suddenly from walking into a door or something. It's really hard to explain and I'm gonna have to try really hard to find some footage of it. I don't have any notes for when it happened to me, unfortunately, but I know it happened like 4 or 5 times, so hopefully I can find an example. It was very distracting, but it never like broke the game. It was just weird. The story of this game is interwoven with the horror atmosphere in such a way that they are entirely inseparable, and it feels like the story drove the design of the levels and mechanics in a way that you don't really get in modern gaming. I'm going to try really hard to not just Wikipedia-style summarize everything here, but there's a lot to go over, so I apologize in advance if that kind of ends up happening. You play as John F.E.A.R. Okay, well, he doesn't actually have a name, and he's only referred to as the new guy or point man in like the manual and such, so I'm not going to officially call him John F.E.A.R. He is a new recruit into the F.E.A.R. program who transferred in just before this incident started. The F.E.A.R., the arm of the army that's designed to handle paranormal and supernatural occurrences, is deployed to stop Paxton Fettel, a guy who apparently is a psychic who controls a battalion of clone soldiers using this power in an attempt to start some kind of rebellion or uprising. However, he might just, like, actually be insane at this point, given the intro, given the cutscene in the intro. He, like, eats the guy, so, like, you know, that's not normal. Since he controls the troops with his abilities, taking him out will turn them all off, so he is your top priority. However, it's revealed early on that there is some form of link between Fettel and John F.E.A.R., as you start to get auditory and visual hallucinations almost immediately. Things as minor as flashes of some disturbing visuals to as intense as full-on teleportation to a different dimension. Through these, you get told the subtext of the story and the relationship between John F.E.A.R., Fettel, and the real star of the show, Alma. You meet Alma pretty early on, as a rather terrifying cutscene plays out of a little girl dressed in red, literally melting the troops that you came in with into piles of bones and goop. She shows up a lot here and there throughout the game, but her overall involvement remains a mystery until close to the end of the game. The first two-thirds or so of the game is you chasing Fettel in various places, meeting more characters, and learning more about what's actually happening behind the scenes. You learn that ATC, a major aerospace player, is actually a military contractor that is behind the creation of Alma and Fettel, and they also dabble in other fields, such as cryogenics. It's revealed that Alma was only 15 years old when she was forced into giving live birth to the two prototypes of psychic soldiers, one of which was Fettel. After these events, Alma was forced into a coma and sealed inside the origin facility underground, but was somehow able to keep a psychic link to Fettel. This link first manifested when Fettel was 10 years old and led to Fettel snapping and killing several people. The second event happened at the beginning of the game, when ATC unsealed the origin facility to look at maybe trying the project again. Wade, the lead researcher at the origin facility and later revealed to be Alma's father, attempts to release Alma and succeeds, only for Alma to immediately kill him and begin attempting to make contact with John F.E.A.R., which of course isn't possible, as you know, she will kill him, so John F.E.A.R. has no choice but to keep running and destroying her psychic apparitions, eventually destroying the facility in the process. Whew, that was a lot to just kind of dump on y'all, and I realize that I'm glossing over a lot of the details, but it's important to note that all of the storytelling is very drawn out in this game, and mostly told to the players via emails and voicemails that the player stumbles upon through the game. In fact, for the first two-thirds of the game, I didn't even think Alma was real. I honestly thought she was just a fabrication created by Fettel because he's going insane. Slowly piecing together what actually happened, learning about how much of a fucking monster Wade really was to his daughter, piece by piece, and slowly figuring out what the ATC really is behind the scenes. It's so compelling, and it's drip-fed in such a way where you're constantly on the search for new voicemails so you can piece together what's happening. The pacing of the story is fantastic, and the characters feel real and human. The voice acting is great, and the writing is top-notch.
He looks okay, but the pilot's dead and Jen's banged up pretty bad.
What about you?
I'll live, but it'll be a while before I can ice skate again.
Also, yes, another Halo connection. That is, in fact, Sergeant Johnson's voice actor. That was a fun thing to discover while playing. Monolith clearly is inspired heavily by movies and their presentation style, and they want to tell a story, and they figured out a way to do it that not only keeps a mystery until the very last possible moment, but also has you second and triple guessing yourself the whole time until the secret is finally revealed. It's masterful, and it's a work of art. And it's such a shame that this style of storytelling just isn't really done in games these days. More games would benefit from this level of writing and this style of writing. And not just the horror genre.
She'll be okay. It's you I'm worried about.
Yeah, I'm fine. As long as I don't move.
Just let me know if you need a little mouth-to-mouth.
Don't make me laugh.
You think I'm joking?
I feel sorry for you if you aren't.
Now that's just cold. Why don't you move along so I can do my thing?
Please stay.
Not even trying with the lighter bit anymore. This is very hot, so I'm going to try to make this quick. Anyway, so thank you guys for watching. This was a fun video, as they all are, and I don't know why I say that every time. I don't know, maybe one day I'll make that video that just was an absolute nightmare, miserable hell world, and I just hated every second of it, and I hate the final product, and I'll never... I don't know. Anyway, yeah, I'm bad at outros, so y'all should be expecting that by now. Good game, though. I really do recommend that everyone play it at least once. Definitely play it through on medium if you're not, like, super into shooters, because it's super easy to just cheese your way through it. And honestly, if you're just sitting around having fun and listening to the story more than playing the actual game, you might have more fun. If you want a survival horror challenge, it's definitely there. It can be there, but it might be a little frustrating. So, I don't know. Just play it on medium. Enjoy the story. Enjoy the spooks. Enjoy the weird, creepy old men. And, yeah, I'm looking forward to playing a normal game next month. So stay tuned for that. And yeah, thanks everybody for watching. It's hard to believe that I'm now at the point where I've done 3 of these. He says, knowing that he started recording these specific shows in 2016 and then took a 3-year hiatus. So, you know, not that much of an achievement. Wait until December. December's gonna be fun. I'll see y'all later before I start to ramble too much. Mwah. Of course, me being a stupid young child, I don't want to blame. Great, that one's like actually still smoldering. I have to actually wait for that one to be put out. I can almost reignite that, Jesus. I'm pretty sure I just got like 9 different kinds of cancer doing that. We'll just wait. So I stare awkwardly into the camera, but you guys won't know because you can't see me right now. Ha ha! Can't wait until I like super ISO boost this one so I'm visible for a blooper at the end. I just gave myself a whole bunch of editing work. Oy.